a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. When you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, don't worry, don't do it. Be happy. Put a smile on your face.
Hello, Seaside. So nice to see you. So excited to be here, and I am so honored to be your host this evening. We have a powerful lineup for all of you. If you're watching online, make sure to let us know where you're tuning in from. We'd love to know. This is the perfect time to check in on Facebook and then to put your phone on silent. Mm-hmm. You are welcome. That is what I am here for, to remind you. And then gift yourself this hour to truly stay here in this space. There is so much that we're going to go through, and I'm so happy and so honored to be here with you all. So today we have an incredible guest artist. He came all the way out here from Phoenix. He is a part, right? He is awesome. Oh, wait, I have more to talk about. So apparently he has 5 kids, and Lezli, you have 5 kids too, right? And right? Isn't that, that's a coincidence. It is. They're married. They told me that. Well, actually, I knew when I booked them. Yeah, that's just how it happened. They're married to each other. To each other. Yes. So we are so lucky to have him up here. So help me give him a warm welcome to Bobby Olander.
I'm gonna help.
I'm in denial that I'm blind. Whoa.
He really is.
Much better. That's pretty. Isn't it?
So this is Christmas. What have you done? another year over, and a new one just begun. And so this is Christmas, I hope you have fun. The near and the dear one, the old and the young, a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Let's hope it's a good one without any fear. So this is Christmas, for weak and for strong, for rich and poor ones. The world is so wrong. When so happy Christmas, for black and for white, for yellow and red ones, stop all the fight. Very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Let's hope it's a good one without any fear. And so this is Christmas, and what have we done?
If you want
another year over, and a new one just begun. When so happy Christmas, we hope you have fun.
If you want
the near and the dear
is
one, the old and the young, very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Let's hope it's a good one without any fear. War is over if you want it. War is over now. Good old John Lennon.
See, I told you they were married. That, yeah. Yes. All right. So, in order to really set the energy here, we have a beautiful, beautiful practitioner that is here with us at Seaside. And just seeing her face when she walks through the door, I'm like, yes, Trudy is here. So that being said, welcome Trudy Seifke for our opening prayer.
Thank you. Gee, the energy in here is so beautiful. Look at this tree and these gorgeous poinsettias. When I sit back here, I have the privilege of seeing folks from a different point of view. And the beauty and the love that these two had when they were singing was absolutely beautiful. So allow yourself to just breathe in with me. And let's let go of the day. Just gently placing a bookmark there, knowing it will be there when we get back. But for now, right now, allow yourself to turn into your heart center, the absolute place where the knowing is that you know, the place that is wise, gentle, and aware. And allow us to go within and recognize the beauty and the allness of the divine, knowing that the divine mind is here and now, has and always will be. Just allow yourself to recognize all roads, all paths lead to this one mind, which is God or whatever label or name. We just know its beauty and grace, its awesomeness in our life. And I unify myself. I just allow myself to be washed with the love be washed with the letting go and the forgiveness of anything that blocks me from being open and learning tonight. And so we invoke the power in the presence, recognizing that each one is here for a divine reason. And we bless all those that are here, both in spirit and in person. If it's on live wire or if it's in our mind right now, blessings, blessings, washing over all. And so each person here, as they give their gift, we just acknowledge it. And for this, I am so grateful. Thankful indeed that we get to commune together in a midweek service. And it is so beautiful. So I simply just let it be and say, and so it is.
Okay. All right, thank you, Trudy. So power up is not only for you guys, it is also for us. So in this space, at this time, I want you to really dig deep and think about the reason why you are here this evening. What are you looking for? What is your intention? So we can really dig deep and find out, what is it that we came here for? What is it that we're looking for? So I'm going to give you a minute so we can go in, go within, and find our intentions. Coming back to our bodies, fluttering our eyes open. Take a second and let us know what your intention for tonight is. You can yell them out. Joy! That gave me joy. Wisdom. Optimism. Healing. Ease. Peace. And for all the intentions said and unsaid, and for all the intentions that we're thinking of in our live stream, together we say, and so it is. Okay, so we have an amazing, a powerful, beautiful, powerhouse speaker this evening. She is the education director at the New Vision in Phoenix, and she came all this way to deliver this powerful message to you. So help me give her a warm welcome to Miss Lezli Goodwin.
Hello, and happy beginning of the Christmas season. I fought hard not to start Christmasing before it was Thanksgiving, so now that it's officially December, I can let my tinsel out of the bag and acknowledge that I love Christmas. I love it. I love trees, I love presents, I love cookies, I love getting all of my 5 kids and all of my nieces and nephews in one house and shoving them full of food. I love it. And I especially love that in this month of talking about Christmas, I get to be the first one, because I like to start the Christmas messages with some Bible. I mean, guys, it's his birthday. We got to get some Jesus in there. If there's one day we have to have some Jesus, it's when we're talking about Christmas. Now, if you're not into Bible, that's okay. I actually didn't used to be. They won me over in ministerial school. I used to kind of be like, that's That's just the last third of the textbook. I can just kind of ignore it. But it turns out, not so much. So if you're not a Bible person, I invite you to kind of put that aside for a moment and let yourself explore what's going to come up in this talk from the perspective of wisdom in everything. Anything that has lasted more than 2,000 years is embedded with wisdom that we can carry forward into our life. So I invite you to look at it from that perspective. If you love you some Bible, if you could quote it back to me, verse and chapter, I invite you to take this other approach of being open to the idea that there's stuff in it that you haven't seen yet. Because I love to find new metaphysical meaning in something that I think I already know. And boy, you can't live in America and not know the Christmas story. I mean, even if you didn't grow up Christian, it's on TV, it's on South Park, it's on the internet, it's everywhere. You couldn't get away, it's in commercials. You couldn't get away from it if you tried. And so here we know the story, right? The story is there is a star in the sky, and it heralds the birth of the new king. Now, the star in the sky, I'm going to go ahead and give you my metaphysical interpretation, and that's it represents the sonship. And as we all look toward the star in the sky, we're recognizing our own sonship. Our own, not just Jesus is the begotten Son, but that we all have that begottenness within us, that Christ consciousness seed is in each one of us. So there's a star in the sky, and the three wise men, they look up, and lo, there is a star. Now, the three wise men were Zoroastrian priests. These were learned guys. These were literally the wisdom carriers of their time. And when they looked up at that star, they knew that what it heralded was the birth of a perfected Christ consciousness onto this planet. And they recognized it because, you know, they're smart, they're trained. And what does that do? It calls everyone who understands to come forth and participate in this blossoming consciousness. Now, I'd probably put it on Facebook. But in the story, we get a star. So the star comes and the wise men, they see it, the three magi, and they decide to go and worship the baby Jesus who's just been born. And worship just means to identify with. They're seeing that another brethren of this wisdom has been born onto the earth. And they bring with them to the baby Jesus three gifts. Arguably the three most famous gifts in all of time. Come on, I know you guys know. They bring frankincense, gold, and myrrh. Myrrh, yes. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, we all know what gold is. It's gold, yeah. Most of us know what frankincense is. It's an aromatic resin. It's an incense. I didn't know what myrrh was. All these times I'd heard about myrrh, I didn't know what myrrh was. It's a perfume. So when we're talking about the most famous gifts ever given, why? Why did the wise men bring these three gifts? And that's what my talk is about today. Why these three? What's the point of gold, frankincense, and myrrh? I mean, they're of great monetary value, then and now, actually. They were really, really expensive, so that's cool. But as we know, money isn't really the point. They had great religious value because all three of those things were really important in temple worship in Jerusalem for the Hebrew people. If you listen to the Old Testament, it goes on for a very, very long time about exactly what is allowed in the temple and what isn't. And you are required to have gold, frankincense, and myrrh, among other things. But they also have a really high spiritual importance. I would argue, and this is my supposition for this talk, I would argue that these three gifts give us the formula for a spiritually satisfying life. I don't believe three wise men from Persia traveled all the way to see a cosmic Christed baby to bring them expensive things. That doesn't make sense to me. I don't believe three epic wisdom leaders traveled thousands of miles to bring a baby things that you need to be a Jew. They were Zoroastrian. I don't think that it mattered that much to them what it took to be a Jew. But I do think that if I were one of those wise people and I saw a star and it told me, ah, another one of your people has been born and someone must teach him or her exactly how to embody this Christ consciousness so that they can be the great leader that they've been born to be, I would travel thousands of miles on camel through the desert to share what I know, to share my wisdom. I argue that these three gifts really do have the pattern in them for how to develop ourselves spiritually. So you can tell me at the end if you think I'm right. So what are these gifts? The first one is gold. We know what gold is. Whether you want to invest in it or make jewelry out of it.
Jewelry, definitely jewelry.
We know what it is. It's a shiny metal. It doesn't oxidize. It's very difficult to destroy. It's soft and easy to work. It's literally riches in material form. At that time, it was money. They would just press it into money. And in a lot of countries, they still do that. But more important than the actual money, what it represents is the ability to manifest in material form. To decide you want something and then to go get it. Now we might call that manifestation. We might call it the law of attraction. Here we would call it the creative process because that's what we do here in Science of Mind. And if you think that it's not important around here, see if any of this sounds familiar. There's a power for good in this world greater than you are, and you can use it. Have you heard that one? You haven't been in this room very much if you haven't heard that one yet. That's Ernest Holmes. There is good for me, and I ought to have it. Emma Curtis Hopkins. Or if you're a little bit more modern, within all of us is a divine capacity to manifest and attract all that we need and desire. It's Wayne Dyer. We're still talking about it. Why? Why are we still talking about the need, the desire, the want, and the how to manifest in material form, be it gold or a boyfriend or a new job? Why are we still talking about it? Well, first of all, it's the first phase of spiritual development. To take the personal responsibility to decide what you want. Boy, that can take time, right? To decide what you want and to actually go for it and to focus your attention to create your own reality. It's a skill set, no joke. And we start teaching it in foundations and we keep teaching it all the way through the end of practitioner and beyond. It's important. I think it's important because it builds faith. When you learn a system and you can do it, act out the steps, and then you get a response from the universe, it's evidence that there really is something out there responding to us. There really is a divine power responding. There really is a law that we're impressing into, and we get stuff. We get gold. Now, baby Jesus probably would have figured this one out. Everybody wants stuff. We're all super motivated to get it. That's why there are more gifts. So what's frankincense? Frankincense is an aromatic incense. It's a resin. And it was used in the temple religions of the day to demonstrate the transmutation of the material into the spiritual. The transmutation of the material, gold, into the spiritual. In modern language, I would call that surrender. So we've worked on our gold, we've manifested our gold, we've got our stuff, we've gotten really, really good at controlling our environment in this first stage. And boy, don't you just know it, as soon as we get really, really good at controlling our environment, it's time to give up that control. It's time to recognize that, yes, now that we have evidence that there is a divine being, I'm sort of gesturing downward as if the divine being is there receiving my orders. And the truth is, it's here. And it has a greater understanding of who we are and our capacity to experience the world than anything we could come up with. So in this second stage of spiritual development represented by frankincense, we give over that power to the grand design, to the flow of life, to the presence, to the peace, to the harmony, to the ease. We relax into it. We talk about this as the third kingdom of consciousness, or the third phase of consciousness. And sometimes I think when we look at the consciousness stages, they go up and down and all over the place, and you move up to 2, 1 is victimhood, oh, we don't want to be there. We get up to 2, we're doing so well, and then it's a slide down to 3. I think it's kind of like chutes and ladders. Like, I know when I'm working on coming down into that place of surrender and letting go of what I think I need and trying to let God do it and trying to trust that the divine has me and I can relax into it, I'm going down that chute going, I don't know that I like it. But there is a place for me. There is a place for each one of us. There is a place for that Christed consciousness that is so big that our human minds can't control it, can't dictate to it. With it comes a deep spiritual conviction and a peace that says all is well no matter what, and an ability to let ourselves be guided by that still small voice. It's represented by meditation. It's represented by that communion with the divine. And yet, as wonderful as that feels to me, there's more. There's a third gift. What, it wasn't enough for them to visit this sweet new example of the possibilities of Christ consciousness. It's that tender new baby. It's like each one of us, as we open up our hearts to the possibilities of what this teaching could offer us, what spirituality has to create in our lives, we're like that new baby. Delicate, tender. We need protecting. We need nurturing. We need our spiritual community. We need our practitioners. We need our ministers. And we need love. Myrrh is this precious, heady perfume. And it was so intoxicating that brides wore it for weeks leading up to their wedding so that they would enthrall the senses and the hearts of their bridegrooms. It represents the absolute adoration of the divine. Not because it gives us anything, not because it's doing anything for us, but because it is. Because there is an energy so infinite, so powerful and so loving and so present that we can reach out and feel it with our hearts. Giving baby Jesus the gift of myrrh is inviting him into an endless lifetime love affair with God. To see the absolute depths of the possibility in this third deepest level of moving beyond faith, moving beyond understanding, and into the depths of mystical grace, where God just is and everything is as it should be. When these wise, magical, powerful, ministerial beings traveled in this story thousands of miles. Imagine that trek from Iran to Israel, across the desert, on camels. There are always camels in the story. To reach out to the newest of their party, to the newest person who has been heralded as a great wisdom seeker. They gave him the blueprint for how to become that great teacher and leader and wise person. I think there's a reason we know gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Those are weird words. I've never had any myrrh, but I know that word. I think that the things that get captured in these stories that become common knowledge, we don't even think about them. Have you literally ever in your life thought, what is frankincense? No, even though we've all said it a gajillion times, right? There's something metaphysical and alchemical going on when we save those tidbits of information. It's because they're not insignificant. The wisdom that is captured in these sacred stories are there, saved, like a snapshot in time, so that at any moment we can go back and really start digging into the meanings and the definitions of these things and say, what's in that for me? We know what was in it for Jesus. Yay, Jesus. Whether you think he was a real person, whether you think he was the only begotten Son of God, whether you think he was a master teacher, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. What matters is the wisdom that's captured in these stories that have been saved by a people for thousands of years so that we can talk about it tonight. Now, you might wonder, what does this have to do with me now? How do I make this information valuable to me this Christmas season when I have to deal with my weird sister or my brother-in-law I don't get along with, or money issues buying all the kids presents, or whatever is going on in your world? Loneliness, inability to travel to be with family members. Everybody's got a story, right? You can't get through life in America without having something going on. We're busy people. So I found a story, a very current Christmas story, that I believe talks about these skills and these areas of spiritual development. So it's a story about Phyllis and her family. And Phyllis was deeply heartbroken when her mother died right before Christmas at age 84. Her mom was an artist and had 5 daughters and 9 granddaughters and this bustling, huge, really loving family. And for nights on end, Phyllis and her sisters got together over dinner and told stories about mom and laughed and cried. And during this time, Phyllis ran across an Ann Landers article that talked about family fighting over what was left when a loved one passed away. And she thought to herself, we are so lucky. That would never happen to us. We get along so well. And sure enough, they split all of the items that mom had, all of her paintings, all of her beautiful furniture, and nary a squabble was to be found until they got to the nativity scene. Now, mom loved this nativity scene. She'd had it since before Phyllis was even born. There were actually arguments about where the nativity scene came from because everybody seemed to have a different story, but everybody loved it. And over the years, the family had collected lots and lots of little figurines to go in the nativity scene. And by the time the grandchildren were there, there were even the 3 little pigs in the nativity scene. And Phyllis's sister, Jolene, wanted the nativity scene. And as the oldest sister and the first to say she wanted it, the other sister said, okay, you can have it. And then Mandy, one of the nieces, said, no. Nana said, I get the nativity scene. That's my nativity scene. She said I could have it. And Jolene wasn't budging. And Mandy wasn't budging. And here we're coming up on Christmas, and half the family isn't speaking to the other half of the family because everybody wants the same nativity scene. So Eleanor, one of the other sisters, is just beside herself. She's Mandy's mom. Jolene is her sister. She's just feeling torn asunder. And she does the only thing that she knows how to do in this moment. which is pray. She prays that God will somehow heal this family. She prays that there's a solution somewhere right where they can see it that will set everything aright. She prays that they find a way to feel into their grief that does not involve tearing each other down. She just prays her little heart out. And as soon as she ends her prayer, the idea comes to her. Now, this is a really simple nativity scene, handmade out of lumber, and she just thinks, I'm going to have another one made. I'm going to have another identical nativity made. And so she takes the nativity piece and she goes to the local hardware store where she meets Brett, the lumber guy. And she pours her heart out. Poor Brett didn't know what hit him. Pours her heart out about how the family's falling apart and everybody wants this nativity scene and she just needs to buy some lumber and she'll find somebody to make the nativity and then maybe, just maybe, everything will be okay by Christmas and we can have a nice Christmas. And he listens and he picks it up and he's like, this? Your family is fighting over this? Like he just, okay, I'll find you the right wood and I'll give you a call when I've got the right wood. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And off she goes. A couple days go by, Brett calls her, come get your stuff. And she comes in, and as she walks into the lumber department, there she sees in front of her not one, but two identical nativity scenes. She can't even tell which one was the original. She really can't. And here comes Brett, and he says, well, you know, I figured I had the wood, and I knew how to do it, so I just put it together. And I noticed that this one had some flaws, so I added them to this too, that little dent there and this little hinge that doesn't quite work right. I pried it open so it wouldn't close quite right so that they really are the same. And she is just, can you imagine, crying, overjoyed, overwhelmed. What do I owe you? I will pay you any amount that you want for doing this. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And he says, your charge is $3.74 for materials. I took it home and made it at my house so that it wasn't on company time so that I could just give it to you for your family. So she takes the nativity pieces home and she calls Jolene and she calls Mandy to come over to the house. And they agree to split the figurines. One person takes one nativity, one person takes the other, and everybody is happy and satisfied. Brett wins the day. Gold. Mandy and Jolie knew what they wanted. They knew how to get it, too. But frankincense, Eleanor took it to prayer and surrendered the whole situation, kit, caboodle, niece and sister, right into the pile. I know there's a solution, and I know that God can bring it to us. And I don't need to say what it is, because if I knew what it is, I would have already done it. She took it to a deeply surrendered prayer. And if myrrh is being guided by divine love, then there is no question to me that Brett was right there in the heart of that myrrh consciousness. He knew what this family needed. He had what it took to do it. And he spent his precious Christmas time helping to heal a family that so desperately needed it. This is not an old story. These are not ancient texts. These are texts for now. This is a lesson for now. So in the call to action speech a little bit later on, we're going to talk about how do we activate gold and frankincense and myrrh during our Christmas season. We've got a month of busy. How are we going to take these lessons into our life this year? Thank you so much, and so it is.
Yeah. All right. That was amazing. It's always amazing when Leslie's here. Always. I don't know. I don't know why. Okay, so this is the time. I'm sorry. You guys get a minute to like marinate in it, and I had to like get up immediately. So I'm still marinating a little bit. Okay. This is the portion where if you have any questions, I know that I have like so many questions, so I'll probably call you this weekend, okay? All right. Ask her. She is here. What questions do you have for her? And what did this bring up for you? And remember, a question that you have, maybe someone who's live streaming didn't get to ask that question, and you're asking them for them, and they're watching now. So I'm coming down. So you may ask your questions. You may raise your hand so that I know that you have a question.
Thank you. Wow. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And so appreciate the way you come from your heart, first of all. I do feel it and appreciate it. One of the very first things, there is a question. One of the very first things that I realized when I became more involved in the teachings of Science of Mind was most everything I thought, if I stopped and thought about my belief at the time and just thought of the opposite, it seemed like the more loving, logical, less fear-based way to go. Do you have other signs or symbols or ways that we can pay attention that we're moving in the right direction, that we have synergy or some flow, and see it? How do we check in?
There are so many ways. One thing I like to ask myself is this what love would do? Whenever I want to, especially if it's in a responding situation, responding versus reacting, is this what love would do? Ernest Holmes said everything is love and everything is law. And we talk a lot about the law, especially at the beginning. Especially at the beginning, we talk a lot about law because it's interesting and it's, you know, it's instructions and we can learn how to do it. But Ernest Holmes also said very late in his life that he wished, if he had one regret, he wished he had talked more about the love. And that is really the deeper place to come from. Of course, we have to learn to get there. That's why it's kind of later in the sequence. But I also think the steps become more important as you work through them. So I like to check in on, is it the love? Kind of a slight tweak on your question. I've been asked, when you hear the still small voice, how do you know if it's just what you want to hear or the voice of the divine operating within you? And I like to say the voice of the divine always makes you feel better. It's always life-affirming, and it never harms yourself or anyone else. So those are some good check-in points. Thank you, Trudy.
That was a great question. That was an awesome answer. Any more questions? It was. Or I can talk all night. But I don't think you guys really want that.
I can answer the unasked question, because if I were in the audience, I would want to say, you said this means this, and this means this, and this means this. Why do you get to pick what it means? One, I have the microphone. But an awful lot of those meanings came from Charles Fillmore's Metaphysical Bible Dictionary, which is like my favorite thing. And if you've never played with it, please give yourself the gift of flipping through it. It has every major word in the Bible and the metaphysical meanings. And oh my gosh, is it fun.
Wow. What is it called?
The Metaphysical Bible Dictionary by Charles Fillmore, who was one of the founders of Unity and was a student of Emma Curtis Hopkins. So there are spiritual cousins.
Okay, Mom, if you're watching, Christmas. I know she is. Are there any more questions that you would like to ask Lezli while she's here? And it could relate to this specific talk or anything that has come up for you during the talk.
I think they're good.
I think they are, too. I mean, I would be, too. I would just be sitting there for a while.
Thank you so much.
All right, guys. So, we are so lucky because we get to welcome Bobby Olander back on the stage.
Oh,
I just have to tell you, I made him create a rock version of this song because it fit my talk. And he's such a sweetheart, he did.
Well, it's medieval. I was all right, so Three Kings, huh? No. Let's see.
We three kings of Orient are bearing gifts, we travel so far, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following on that yonder star. Born a king on Bethlehem plain, gold to bring to crown him again, king forever, cease and never, over us all he's gonna reign. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star of your beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guiding us to that perfect light.
Yeah, it's a little more fun to play too.
Frankincense to offer do I, incense owns a deity's night, prayer and praising, all men raising toast, worship him all night. Oh, glorious now, behold him arise, the king and god of sacrifice, heaven singing hallelujah, hallelujah, the earth replies. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star of all your beauty prize, a westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to that perfect light, guide us to that perfect light.
That was so fun to figure out.
Wow, only Bobby can make a Christmas song like so like hip and cool, right? Like I've never heard that version. That's amazing. That's cool. Wow. I like that one. Okay, I'm gonna watch this later. So as Lezli had promised you a call to action so that we could really figure out and really learn from her how to use these metaphysical gifts in our daily lives. Promised you more, Lezli, and here she is with her call to action.
Okay. I wish you many, many gifts this Christmas. Whatever you ask for, I know it's under your tree. And how are we going to use the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh as we head into our Christmas holidays? So for gold, we're accessing the energy of the gift of gold every time we ask ourselves, what am I believing here? What am I really thinking? And rather than choosing to just knee-jerk believe our thoughts, pausing and looking and questioning ourselves. Because gold is about the creative process. Gold is about spiritual mind treatment. Gold is about using our thoughts to create our reality, recognizing when we're just mirroring back what we think we're going to see. So when we pause, when we use affirmations, when we breathe instead of snap, we're tapping into gold. Frankincense is surrender. And my favorite Christmas wish for everyone within the sound of my voice is that we remember to do what we know how to do during the busy Christmas season. This is what I invite us to do. Meditate every day. 20 minutes every day for the whole month of December. We know it works. We know it keeps us centered. And we can sometimes let it fall away when life gets busy. So take the time to meditate And before every time you're going to be with your beloveds, pray in. Sitting in your car before you walk into the Christmas party, pray in. It takes a minute to affirm the experience that you want to have and that you want to give as a beloved person at that Christmas party, at that work event, at that family gathering. That's a great way to be the gift of frankincense. And myrrh, being divine love at Christmas is as simple as taking a breath and looking into the faces of the people that you love and remembering not what time the turkey is supposed to come out, not what ribbons you still have to tie around which gifts, but remembering the magic of the people in your life. Christmas is beautiful. Christmas is beautiful. But Christmas is beautiful. It's the one time of year more than any other that we take the time to all get together. This year, as we anchor into the consciousness of myrrh, let it be the one time that we take the time to really see the loving hearts that are our families and our friends. So we're going to be conscious of our thoughts. We're going to meditate, and we're going to pray in every time, every meeting, every party, every gathering. And we're going to really let ourselves take the time to love the people we love. Because love is a verb. We're going to be love. That is my invitation to myself, which is why I write all my talks, is for myself. And that is my invitation for all of you as well. Have a very Merry Christmas. And so it is.
Isn't she amazing? I just love watching her. Okay. All right. Thank you. This is a time during our service when we as a community get to thank and appreciate this center for this service, for everything else that it helps us and supports us with. Participating in the law of circulation helps each one of us become more generous and more prosperous people. For everything we give comes back to us amplified and increased. So I will invite the ushers to come forth. And I invite you to place your financial gift over your heart. Trudy will come on up, and we will do this affirmation together. This gift I give is God in action. I give it in joy. I give it in love. I give it in gratitude for all the good in my life. And so it is.
We know together that the blessing and the flow of life is abundance of an inflow and an outflow. And we recognize one way to symbolically show our joy and acceptance and absolute knowing that this place feeds our soul is to show up in terms of abundance in form of tithing and money. And so, Father, Mother, God, we recognize that as we give, of course, we receive. And so I am choosing to be in the flow tonight and choosing to participate and just loving all of the beautiful outpouring that Seaside gives myself, families, and all of our community. And thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Father, Mother, God. And so it is.
So, they're laughing because I've been playing with this clicker for like 3 hours now, just pressing the buttons back and forth. And here we are. I am a professional clicker. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So this is a portion where we get to really, really connect and let us know how are things going with you? What are things that you want to talk about? What are things that have come up for you? Last week we had Nicole, who is also a ministerial student, and she talked to us about going into the mystic, and really, she really talked to us about spirit and having faith, and how she even did the walk on fire. Remember? Yeah. So, what came up for you this week? How did we take that talk into our week? Or if there's anything else you'd like to talk about, this is a community. And I would like to hear your beautiful voices. Or you could just listen to me. So this week, I really had to like sit down and meditate and pray. And why? Because life. Yeah, life happened. I'm a human being too, and you know, things occur. And lo and behold, this beautiful woman came up to me and she asked me that if I ever wanted to pray, that I could call her. Yeah. Trudy. And she didn't even know. She had no idea. And all I did was pray, like, can I have somebody to help me, please? That's my crying voice. That's how it sounds all the time. So that happened for me, and I realized during your talk that that's what it was. I knew what I wanted. I prayed about it. And then I just surrendered. And Trudy, lo and behold, walked into the doors with her smiling face.
Bringing her myrrh.
Bringing her myrrh. She like she's myrrh all over, all day, every day.
It may not be relevant to the Christmas, wonderful Christmas speeches, but I had decided not to come this evening because I was very tired and other things had intruded on my life that wore me out. So I was okay with that. She's just not going to come. And something in my mind said, well, that's all right. You don't have to. Why don't you just get showered and dressed and ready? And said, I will do that, but you know that I'm not going. I said, that's okay. So I don't know how to say this, but so I just I just showered and got dressed and ready. I said, okay, I'm just going to sit on the couch like this in my going out clothes instead of old stuff. And did it, and just something happened. I looked at my watch, got up, and just came to the session. So I don't wish it was. I wish it was that way in every area of my life, but it happened tonight and for this, and I guess that's grace.
Yeah.
We're glad you're here.
I love that. I have one. I always have one. I watched live stream from Phoenix when Nicole was giving her talk last week. Not only is it Power Up, which I would never miss, but Nicole is a dear friend as well. And so, I mean, how fun is that? And I think that if you watched both talks, that it's pretty apparent that her call to go into the mystical and to feel into that deeper realm very much informed this talk. I was feeling very tired. I haven't been very physically well. I was worn out and really kind of didn't know where to go with this talk beyond the basics. And watching her talk and taking it in carried me through writing the rest of the message.
Is there anyone else that would like to share? Oh.
So I experienced a demonstration after several months of prayers and spiritual mind treatments and visualization. I finally got my car completely cleaned out and the clutter removed from it. And it had been something that had been blocking my energy for a really long time, and it feels great.
Woo! Yeah! Decluttering. That's awesome. I need to do that. Okay. Well,
That's all for tonight, because I know you guys have tons to talk about, and I still want to talk to you guys in the family room while we're eating those cookies. So I'm going to save it for then. But I really want to thank you guys. I want to thank you guys for being here. I want to thank you for the energy that you bring, because that energy is what I use while I'm up here. I want to thank you for your consciousness, whether you're here in this room or if you're watching on the live stream. I want to thank Melanie for sound. I want to thank Tim and Gregory for your visuals. I want to thank, oh, claps. I'm from New York, so I talk really, really fast all the time. It's true. Ginny, thank you, coordinating here. Dennis as well. Thank you, Victoria, for holding the light, holding the space of this evening. Thank you, Trudy, for your beautiful presence and your prayer this evening. Yeah, Trudy! Of course, we're going to thank Bobby Olander for his wonderful, beautiful music. And thank you, Lezli, for your consciousness and for your talk and for your everything. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm just so filled with, like, yeah. I'm powered up. I don't know about you, but I am. Okay, so we're all going to stand up for our congregational song by Bobby Olander.
By Ricky Byers and Michael Beckwith. Yeah, I couldn't figure out the piano version, so.
I release and I let go. Let the spirit run my life. Then my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only for God. No more struggles, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only for God. I release and I let go. Let the spirit run my life. Yeah, my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only for God. No more struggles, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only for God. I release and I let go. Let the spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only for God. No more struggles, no more strife. With my faith, I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only for God. Said I'm free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only for God.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. I'm so happy that you were here. I would love to talk to you in the family room where there are cookies. Please eat the cookies. Oh, and there are clementines, I think. What are those little orange things? Tangerines. Halos. All right.